Welcome, everybody. Thanks for coming out on this Sunday afternoon to the, this is the seventh lecture of nine lectures that we'll have in conjunction with the Emergence National Arts of Central Illinois show that's upstairs. I see a lot of familiar faces, so I think everyone's probably seen the show. I'm here to introduce two of the 57 artists, Andrea Farigno and Mark Holmes, that are in the show. They're both from Knox College and Paul Galesburg, their home. And we'll start with Andrea and take some time for some questions, and then we'll have Mark come up and give his talk. Before we start, I just want to say thank you from the museum for the artists involved in the show. Thank you, Andrea, for curating the show with me and picking the artists from Knox. We got to give a hand of thanks to John and Sharon Amdahl for sponsoring the show. Give them a hand. Sid Rudrigal and Andrew Mann also contributed to the show, and all the visionary members and members of the museum. So thank you very much, and thanks for coming out today. I'd like to introduce Andrea Farigno. Give her a hand, please.
Thank you, and thanks, Zach, for putting me in this, and for Riverfront, and for all of you coming out today. These are the two pieces that are in the show, so I wanted to start so you kind of know what I'm talking about. I'm going to kind of lay out my influences and talk about how I ended up where I did with this particular body of work. It shows you different ways that I work as a branch off, and some more images of this body of work. Some images I'll just slow down and go through, so if there is any questions, feel free to shout them out. So kind of zooming back to the beginning of my artistic career, I was studying Monet, was really interested in architecture in this kind of ephemeral moment that Monet was trying to capture, and then became more interested in the geometry and to how these things sit next to each other, this kind of sense of permanence and architecture and this underlying geometry paired with the fleeting moment of light and color. I was challenged back in undergrad to think about the human body and think about it in a way to create a series of paintings. And I quickly found myself working, learning about the sacred geometry and different geometries that link the human body to architectural forms and to mathematical ideas such as the Fibonacci sequence. And so the image on the right, Jose, and talking about how the body can be broken into certain intervals that relate to wavelengths and harmonics as well. Other early things that I was looking at, the Vitruvian Man in Da Vinci, this is overlaid with the Flower of Life and these different kind of natural patterns in the universe. And I was interested in this kind of way of knowing the world and how the human endeavor of trying to understand all the complexity of these natural forms and break them down into a language of geometry. And again, how all these kind of geometries and this mathematical and scientific understanding of the world quickly moves into areas of philosophy, metaphysics, and how we try to understand the world, these kind of ultimate truths of the world. So I began kind of studying Platonic forms, studying Platonic geometry. I also took a course in undergrad on topology, which the bottom left image is a series of topological knots, or like the Klein bottle that can kind of move and twist without breaking itself. The image on the left is kind of sections thinking about the sections of the universe, wavelengths, and forms. So I'm not an expert in any of these things, but I enjoyed trying to learn more about them as a way to feed my practice. I'm interested in these forms as well as how we map biological forms and still are studying the structure of natural forms and as well as how they relate to emergent phenomena of man-made systems such as the map of the internet, or we look at traffic and how these things that we create have parallels to natural systems. Early artists, I spent a lot of time looking at Paul Klee. Maybe too long, but I really got into reading all about his genesis of his own form language and really breaking down his own belief system on the way space functions, these visual rhythms. And he was very influential of some early work, which this is an example. I don't have a ton of examples of a lot of earlier work, but really thinking of this kind of atomic space, the structure of an atomic space, mapping these little forms geometrically. The work was pretty tight and rule-based and kind of driven to hold to the structures that I was learning about. Terry Winters, I'm still really interested in his work. You can see in the evidence, he's working with topological forms, those knots. That's how he's reiterating those through his paintings. Hilda Alpint is also someone that I was really interested in and still interested in. I'm going to show the Guggenheim to get to. And really having this whole belief system on kind of how through math and art and science the secrets of the universe could be revealed. And as this, I kept kind of expanding, you know, they started from this architecture, basic math, and then I just kind of keep branching out and trying to understand more. I began really interested in thinking about how could I, instead of trying to mimic what these forms look like, how could I mimic the way that they are made? How could I like use the mark and use my tool to mimic particle collision, and how that also could be in conversation with the digital space and drawings created by algorithm, trying to mimic those things. So these are some early drawings that were, you know, mimicking. I'd watch these particle collision videos and try to make my hand move in the same ways that I was watching unfold. And I started thinking more about just systems as themselves, as systems as an end of themselves, as well as how they can relate to things in the world, both natural and man-made. And my work, too, it tends to kind of contract and become a little more tightly wound, and then wants to open up and become more expressive or more physically engaged. Those last drawings are fairly modest size, like 20 inches or so. And then these were large. The picture on the left is about the size of a full body. So I was taking all this information that I was gleaning and trying to work it back into the drawing in a way to kind of map the relationship to my body with this, as well as, again, kind of describe and develop new forms through this active system. I was also at the same time looking at a lot of things under a microscope, was interested in biology. And a side note, I found out, I met my biological family, I was adopted, and all of a sudden I became a different sort of conviction in what genes really do, and found a lot of similarities between myself and my natural family. So I became more interested in biology and developmental biology. So this is kind of these nesting spheres, these cellular forms. And the image on the left is a monoprint. They're both prints. This one's a silk screen on the left. Another one's a monotype, which is kind of a painterly approach to printmaking. That is both thinking again about this kind of this movement of nature, as well as kind of mapping an architectural element over that. This work is getting a little bit more recent. I was kind of feeling a need to kind of work on a more intimate scale. These are quite small, 11 by 13 inches. Interested in just kind of these more intimate works. And so this is also thinking about kind of this collision, these movement of particles, as well as thinking about language and handwriting. So there's some kind of secret messages in there, which has been another interest of mine, and I'm not talking about that in this talk today. So these are a few other again, kind of how this, kind of questioning if I emerge, you know, engage with this process, what kind of forms emerge from it. So these works aren't planned, they're really discovered through this generative drawing system. These are about 3 years old. This is a mezzotint, which is a print technique done by burring up a copper plate, so it's really rough, so ink sticks everywhere, and then scraping back away, so the white lines have been scraped and burnished smooth so that the ink doesn't stay there. So I'm thinking about how I can implement color within these pieces too, and how color changes the read of the works. I have another side project and thing that's still kind of on the back burner that I'm thinking about is the relationship of sound to the visual. And so this is first Chladni and his experiments. Some of you might be familiar with how he was had a steel plate and strung the violin string on the side, and depending on what sort of pitch or octave that was, the pattern changes and emerges. So the pattern on the top right is a tighter frequency, higher frequency than the one, you know, right next to him, the lower frequency. So I was able to acquire, you could also do this through a function generator that produces a particular pitch or frequency. Oh, this is a little bit before. So these are, this is also an intaglio print etching done using a needle on a piece of plastic, thinking about a way to transcribe some of his patterns and shift the language of it in the process. And I was able to acquire this function generator plates, and I've been making these printmaking plates that I could reproduce these patterns with, so it fixes the image on the plate. So this is kind of a collection of them that I've been doing. I think kind of my next question to this is kind of how I can sequence them and think about them a little bit more particularly as they could correspond with harmonics. It's a little washed out. And these are a couple of experiments working, printing these different plates on top of each other with different colors. And going back to drawing, these are not unlike some drawings that have come before and after, but these were definitely responding to these different experiments and making these plates and watching sand move around, finding patterns through this sound. So some of this same information is within these forms. And again, trying to think again about color, the different mark making. I do like working in a lot of different media because I'm interested in how the character of the work can shift when I'm working with a tiny intaglio needle to an oil pastel and the way that that changes the read of the work. I feel like once I start to get too comfortable or know how a thing works, I like to switch. I think this is kind of a pivotal piece from the work I was doing to the work that's in the show now, where I have been thinking a lot of these lines and marks as planes, but they typically run as patterns. So I was kind of curious, how could I use color to affect the spatial read, affect the read more particularly as far as memory or particular sense of place and spatial relationships of color. And I began looking a lot at Joseph Albers and particularly interested in, well, his geometric forms, as well as, especially his ideas in his book, The Interaction of Color, and the idea of color transparency, I'm really fascinated with on how color as a whole, the problems of it, how we don't really know where it's located. It is this kind of space between our experience, inward experience, and the reality of the world, and how we perceive color as this thing that you can move in and out of visually. So his work and studies were a major influence on the current body of work. And also, this is Sean B. Carroll's book, from The Endless Forms Most Beautiful. And he's trying to, I think, in very layman's language, talk about how form emerges, develops from DNA into biological forms. And so he's kind of talking about the way that the body, like at an embryonic stage, becomes a map, and how the DNA communicates in a way to kind of branch out these forms. So again, to try to understand this, I like to try to read it and think about it even more visually than they offer on how does that actually happen. And you know, I'm not aiming for accuracy of depicting these things, but it really is a way just to fuel my work and challenge my own thinking. So again, and then the kind of branching of a tree form and how this thing just kind of grows. I also think of that as kind of a metaphor for my practice as a whole, just kind of branching out in different directions, giving myself the freedom to do that. There's some current artists that I've been reading a lot about and interested in. I've been a long time interested in Arthur Dove and his kind of spiritual landscapes, use of color, and also his interest in trying to translate sound through painting. And there's a variety of artists too that influenced my thinking, and Sophie Tabar-Arp and for use of color and form. Contemporary artists, Toma Apps and Jason Kerouac, are kind of people I like to think that I'm in communication with my work. Toma Apps was a winner of a Turner Prize, I think in 2013, and Jan Verwoerd was the judge, and he's a critic that I'm also really interested in, and how these artists were, Toma Apps in particular, kind of this anti-heroicism to painting, whereas someone like Kerouac, Duchamp, or Pollock, you know, they're working with painting as a way to kind of make the last move. Duchamp thinking of the chess game as making the last move or ending the conversation, and how we can work to open up new space and new possibilities. And thinking of, you know, talks about painting as this kind of echo chamber, and I really like that analogy. So I began this series of works, which I'll show you a few of. You can kind of see the similarity of these kind of branching systems, thinking of modular growth. Certain ones, like the one on the left, I'm thinking more about, yeah, how this like plant-like form could grow, or this modular growth. So that was a little bit touching into the particular idea of a form, where the one on the right is more setting up, you know, I set up this kind of areas of black and white, set up systems of the full color spectrum, and allow those things to map and kind of find each other. I'll just flip through some of these. Most of these have sizes on here. Some of them became a little quirkier. I've been trying to be a little more playful, allow for humor into them. Some of my decisions with color are informed by memory. There was a painting, and I was thinking of my mother's geraniums, and that particular red was my starting point. And other times that's evoked along the way. I just start working with, I do believe, the muse must find you working, so sometimes, you know, just get going and put some color on there. And I do think making work, looking at paintings, allows you to move through time in a different way. Like this body surfing one, it was kind of evoked along the way of an experience I had, an effort at body surfing that didn't go very well. And again, I'm thinking of this geometry. I'm starting to think about the body, the image on the left is, you know, definitely thinking this kind of figurative element wants to come back into these works more directly. A little interruption, during this time I was able to do a residency in kind of the south area of France at Draw International in Caylus, France. So this is an image of the village, this medieval village. Everything in this village was very old, very crusty, like textures like I've never been around. There's layers of moss, you know, that are 500 years old and everything. So I was, you know, my studio was here and overlooking this area. And before the visit, we went to visit a lot of the cathedrals. I was able to visit Monet's cathedral at Rouen. During this time too, I went and visited the Pecnal prehistoric caves, which are sort of a few places you can still access physically. And both were really moving experiences. And I'm fascinated by that history of painting that dates back to prehistoric times. This was some other structure I became really obsessed with. This was down on a walk I would go on regularly in the village I was at. So love this kind of monumental statue. And these weird little old artifacts of old dwellings. So I just kind of show a few images from my time there that I feel like are still, I made all this work while I was there, really intense. You know, the residency allows you to work uninterrupted. You know, you can see the evidence of working, thinking about both the caves and thinking about all, responding to these textures that I'm around. And these are fairly large-scale drawings, at least like 4 feet tall by 3 feet wide. I had another body of work that I didn't show right now, but it was kind of working these like pathways, these dots that are both thinking of like footsteps in a way you would move through space as a body, as well as some of these kind of cellular forms. And then I returned and kind of dove back into this work. And again, kind of been trying to challenge my use of color. I kind of tend to throw everything in there, which I also, something about using this unrestrained use of color, like just letting the painting keep calling for more and more color, these prismatic spaces I'm interested in. And also how I can bring more particularity into them and push some of the, my choices of color and how maybe making some areas more subdued. This was actually the one on the right was probably would have ended up more like the one on the left, and I started, it was very colorful, and then the election happened, and it's just praise for the rest of that painting. And so I'm interested with these systems again on how I can communicate as much as possible. So these are both thinking kind of like growth forms of crystals, as well as thinking about a digital space, digital network. But all of these works on color, like you see upstairs, are wash on panel, kind of an acrylic wash, just like watercolor, but more opaque. And again, thinking about the body, kind of playful. I've been trying to get quirkier and like increasingly break out of the systems that are generating them. Pushing a sense of light. At the same time, still making these drawings that are investigating what can line alone do. And these are also fairly large scale, 50 by 30 drawings. And this is also a way to not worry as much about how they're going to get mapped over with color. I guess one way to talk about my use of color is the paintings are started with this kind of underlaying painted structure, not unlike these pieces. And then the paint and the application, the form modifies and changes as I work on it, but this also, the color kind of tries to modularly map over these forms. And I also work on a variety of prints. The one on the right is a linoleum cut. It wasn't initially when I started either, it didn't have such a figurative presence, and then all of a sudden it was just there and kind of undeniable. And the other is a stone litho. And I mentioned on drawing, you know, when I kind of tighten up, and the space opens up in a different way. Other recent explorations have been taking these paintings and separating the color files and laser cutting each file. So these are kind of four printmaking blocks, kind of trying to put back together the paintings and play around with things that can happen by switching and rotating. And thinking more about the figure, this is a recent print, an intaglio print that I have a ton of these drawings, like the one on the right, that I anticipate turning into a series of these prints. Kind of questions I'm asking now is how could I kind of push my use of paint, the language of paint? I've been working very kind of restricted in planar, clear planar forms and shapes, and really challenging myself with that, using paint in different ways, letting it get messy, letting the paint strokes stay there. So I'm trying to kind of open this thing back up, and as well as continue this kind of series of prints. I like these two together. And that's it. And so this is kind of a bunch of my sketchbook. I do try to draw on nearly a daily basis, at least just getting something on paper and keeping that momentum going in some way. Thank you.
Does anybody have any questions?
Yeah.
If you don't have an affinity for math, would you do take the four basic forms and a compass and play with it?
Yeah, early that's how it started. A lot of my undergrad, I got exposed to these kind of sacred geometry, platonic geometry, and I spent time just playing around with the compass and ruler. I did take a course in topology, so I did learn a little bit more. I was kind of forced to do these visual calculations. Yeah.
So your work is all basically handmade printmaking, drawing. Does the digital realm come in at all into your work?
Well, I think about it a lot. I think about being in conversation with it. I think of like emulating it. A lot of it too is, you know, we're looking at how science explains us forms, like explains us particle collision. That's all done through a computer. So I've been kind of curious, how can I be that computer, mimic that kind of process? I do, like the recent prints were done digitally. I do use the computer a bit. I've done, started to do some digital drawings, and I'm working with a digital artist who all of his work exists only in code or in graphic computer language, and working to print some of that 3D and create more handmade objects from that. But it's always been important to maintain a sense of the hand. I mean, initially became an artist because I didn't want to sit at a computer all day. It was a big part of it. As it panned out that way, but yeah.
With the color, you've got, in some sense, not an algorithm, it's too strong a word for the forms.
Yep.
You also have something parallel in terms of the way in which you arrange and parse?
I've given myself a lot more, I think, freedom with that, but in the same way, like with something, especially the one on the left, I was kind of like, all right, I'm going to set up these primary colors, and I set those up, and then had to challenge myself to somewhat seamlessly, or, you know, allow those colors to then map over it. A lot of times, it will be kind of a clear system where this color is shifting and moving, and then I go off in a different direction, but then you get stuck and you gotta find, you know, those places for those colors to come back into conversation with it. I mean, when I originally started these, it was kind of set up with that question on how I could, you know, set up these different questions of color. Well, that other one was similar, but, you know, I set up this black and white, you know, orb, and then this color orb, and it was like, I've gotta like walk the color over to this other color. Yep.
This might be more a comment than a question, but if you'd like to address it, that'd be great. I just wanted to kind of refer to the tensions that you create within when color meets color. It seems to be a lot of decisions how things go together. It appears there are lighter lines that happen and sometimes darker lines. Is that true, number one, or is this a kind of a slide effect, like an optical effect that's happening? And then the last part, you can address that, and then the last part is also the tension within the square or in the rectangle, how you're pushing toward the corners and the edges, referring to those all the time. It's just wonderful tensions.
I do think of them as their own, like I like that idea of like an echo chamber or a bubble chamber. This is where everything's got to exist, and the forms to be very aware of their parameters. So I'm very conscious of that. And in some ways, too, like the old video game Pong, you know, that line goes up because the edge just got to, like, bounce off of that. So that is a lot of how they're generated. I think as far as the colors are a bit off on this screen, but I am trying to think of these, you know, as I'm using color somewhat just to see what happens. You know, they become systematic in the way that, okay, what's going to emerge from this process? And in other ones, even like the one on the left, then it's becoming a bit more sculptural or thinking, okay, you know, I put this color down and it's going to really feel like it's scooping out the underside of perhaps an arch and feel like something that is more physical or could exist in a physical 3D space. Is that what you were first? I couldn't quite, that's how it worked.
Yeah, that's great.